In this video, we will first discuss the elastic force, and then we'll discuss the potential energy associated with the elastic force. In general, the elastic force is associated with an object that will return back to its original shape after being stretched or compressed. Common elastic objects are springs, rubber bands, and rubber balls. Springs are the most common elastic object discussed in this course, and you'll find that I will often refer to the spring force when I'm actually referring to the elastic force in general. When dealing with elastic objects, we will typically make the approximation that elastic objects do not dissipate heat or any type of energy when they are stretched or compressed, and as a result, we will consider the elastic force to be a conservative force. To discuss the elastic force in detail, let's consider a block that rests on a horizontal surface. I'll attach one end of a spring to the block and the other end of the spring to a fixed wall. Let's say that in the picture, the spring is neither pushing or pulling the block and the block is at rest. The position where the spring is not compressed or stretched so that it does not apply a force to the objects that it is in contact with is defined to be the equilibrium position of the spring. We will also apply a coordinate scheme to define the amount that the spring is stretched or compressed. By tradition, we will use an x-axis for this purpose. The axis should be parallel to the spring, as I've shown it here. Also, the equations for the elastic force and the elastic potential energy that we'll write down momentarily require that the origin of the x-axis, that is to say, where x equals 0, to be located at this equilibrium position. Here are the two rules that I just mentioned for drawing the coordinate scheme. The x-axis must be parallel to the spring, and x equals 0 is located at the equilibrium position. And I'll add one more rule. The positive x direction is arbitrary. So in the example shown, I arbitrarily defined the positive x direction to be to the right, but I could have defined it to be to the left. Now let's consider what happens if we slide the block to the right so that the spring is extended like this. As you can imagine, the spring will pull the block back to the left. So the spring force on the block looks like this. Or if we slide the block to the left of the equilibrium position like this, then the spring will be compressed and the spring force will push the block back to the right like this. Based on these observations, we can write down a couple of rules about the direction of the elastic force. The direction of the force is opposite the direction of the displacement, i.e. opposite the direction that the spring has been displaced from equilibrium. This means that the spring force on an object will always point back toward the equilibrium position. Now let's define the equation for the elastic force. From your own experience, you know that the magnitude of the spring force increases the more the spring is stretched or compressed. This means that the equation must have an x in it. Robert Hooke developed a simple equation for this force that we commonly refer to as Hooke's law. While this equation applies to any elastic force that we will discuss, an S subscript is commonly used in reference to a spring. In this equation, the K is the spring force constant, or it may just be called the spring constant, or it may be called the force constant. It's a property of the object. So a particular spring or a particular rubber band, as an example, has a spring force constant of, say, K equals 90 newtons per meter, while another spring might have a spring force constant of, say, K equals 700 newtons per meter. The larger K is, the stiffer the spring is, so a spring with a large spring constant will have a greater force for a given displacement. The SI units for the spring force constant, which can be seen in the equation, are newtons per meter, and x in the equation is the coordinate value of x and represents how much the spring is stretched or compressed. Notice that there is a negative in the equation as well, because the direction of the force is opposite the direction of the displacement. Now let's develop an equation for the potential energy associated with the elastic force. In this video, I will provide a brief derivation. A more detailed derivation can be found in textbooks. Recall that the fundamental definition of potential energy is the change in the potential energy is equal to the negative of the work. So applying this equation to the elastic force, I'll add an S subscript to each term. Again, the S is typically used referring to a spring, but it applies to the elastic force in general. And now off to the side, let's calculate the work for the spring force. If we apply this equation for work, there is a problem. This equation is only valid when the force is constant, and as we know, the spring force varies with x, so it's not constant. However, we can still use this equation if we use the average spring force. Let's consider each of the variables in this equation. For theta, the angle between the spring force and the displacement is always 180 degrees. For the displacement, we can use this equation to calculate the work done to displace a spring from the equilibrium position to location x, so the displacement is just the x variable. And now let's consider the average force. Because Hooke's law is linear, the average force is just half of the spring force at location x. So making these substitutions, the equation becomes this. Next, we can substitute in Hooke's law for the spring force, which gives us this result for the work. And now we want to substitute this into our original equation, but remember that we just calculated the work to stretch or compress the spring from the equilibrium position to location x. So what we've actually derived is an equation for the spring potential energy at location x, as opposed to the change in the potential energy between two x values. Still, that's not a problem. If we'd like to find the change in potential energy between any two values of x, it can easily be found by recognizing that delta PE is the final PE minus the initial PE, and then we can substitute in the equation just derived for each of these terms, the final and initial potential energies. And then that gives us delta PE. If we want, we can also factor out the 1/2 k, so the equation becomes this. So now that we have an equation for the elastic potential energy and therefore the change in the elastic potential energy, the last thing I'd like to do is just to expand the conservation of energy equation to include the spring potential energy. And so that's everything I wanted to show you in the video, but be sure to also review the worked out examples that are posted for the spring force and for the spring potential energy.